Hello students, I am V.L.N. Swarupini, lecturer in biochemistry from Sri Venkateswara College of Arts and Sciences, which is affiliated to Adikavi Nannaya University, Rajahmundry. Now, I would like to discuss about third B.Sc. biochemistry, sixth paper, that is molecular biology and recombinant DNA technology. And this is for the fifth semester students. And this paper contains 5 units, and the first unit is DNA replication and transcription, in which we will discuss majorly about the structure of the gene, experimental proofs for DNA as genetic material, DNA replication, models of it, and experimental proofs for these replication models. Particularly for this semi-conservative model of DNA replication, and enzymes required for replication process like DNA polymerases, helicase, topoisomerases, primase, ligase, and DNA replication in E. coli, and also inhibitors of DNA replication. So these are the topics related to DNA replication that we are going to discuss in this unit. And also topics related to transcription, we are going to see about RNA polymerase enzyme and its role in prokaryotes, mechanism of transcription. Okay, in transcription we'll be having 3 steps: initiation, elongation, and termination, and aspects related to these 3 steps: initiation, elongation, and termination, and also inhibitors for transcription. So these are the overall topics that we are going to discuss in our first unit. Okay, so let's start with the first topic, nature and structure of the gene. First of all, what is gene? Gene is a small segment which is present in the DNA, and collection of genes are genetic material DNA is made up of. That means DNA consists of many segments of genes, and these are collectively called as DNA. Okay, and in actually, where is our DNA is present? In each and every cell will be having a genetic material in the form of DNA, and every cell contains a nucleus. And on this in this nucleus, chromosomes will be present, and over those chromosomes these genes will be present, and these genes collectively are called as DNA. Okay, now let's see in detail about this topic, nature and structure of the gene. Hope this material is visible to you. Yes. Okay, genes are segments of deoxyribonucleic acid that contains the code for the specific protein that functions in one or more types of cells in the body. That means, as I told earlier, this gene is a segment of DNA. It is a segment of DNA, and it carries a code for specific proteins, and these proteins will function in not only in one cell. These genes may work in multiple cells. That means more than one cell. Okay, and why, first of all, why only DNA is considered as genetic material? Why DNA is considered as genetic material? Just think about this question. I'll answer this question in the next video. Why only DNA is called as genetic material in humans? Why not RNA? As we have, of course, we have DNA as a genetic material, but along with DNA in our body, we'll also have RNA and different types of RNA in our body, but DNA functions as genetic material and not RNA. And why so? okay? Just think about the answer. I'll answer in the next class, okay? And coming to this gene, this is a segment of DNA, and this carries specific code for different kinds of proteins, okay? Each gene carries a code for one particular or specific protein, okay? And these chromosomes are structurally within the cells that contain genes, okay? As I explained earlier, nucleus, every cell will have a nucleus, and this nucleus will have chromosomes on which these genes are present, okay? And what is the purpose of the gene? This will carry a code for particular protein. That means finally for any gene expression, or finally for protein expression, this gene will carry a code, okay? And in our body, DNA gets replicated, and finally replicated DNA will undergo transcription process for the formation of mRNA, which is a messenger RNA. That means it will carry a particular message, genetic message will be carried by this mRNA, and this mRNA is converted into protein by the process called translation. And for this whole process, gene is the base point, okay? And if you see the structure of the gene, if you see this diagram, you can have a better idea. This is a fragment of gene in which we'll see enhancer or silencer to the both ends, and a regulatory sequence followed by this enhancer or silencer gene fragment. And after this, we'll see start and stop regions, and in between the start and stop region, we'll see open reading frame, okay? So this is the coding region, okay? So open reading frame, the codons which are present in this open reading frame will be coded, okay? After transcription by post translational modifications, open reading frame will be separated from the enhancers and silencers and regulatory gene, and a poly N tail will be added for developing a matured mRNA. Okay, this matured mRNA is produced after transcription process, and this mRNA is again converted into protein by translation process. And as we discussed, it consists of enhancer or silencer, enhancer and silencer, and a regulatory sequence, start region. Start region means encoding will start from this point, and stop region, it will where the coding will be stopped at this point. And between the start and stop regions, we'll have an open reading frame. Now let's see what are they. First, regulatory sequence. Obviously, regulatory means it will regulate the expression of that particular gene. That means expression might be increased or expression might be decreased. By regulatory sequence will play an important role in that gene expression, okay? And it may increase or decrease the expression of a specific gene. And the next one is promoter sequence. Promoter sequence. Transcriptional factors bound to promoter sequence followed by RNA polymerase binds to initiate transcription. Okay, what is the role of this promoter sequence? Basically, for the initiation of the transcription process, nothing but to start transcription process, firstly transcriptional factors will come and bind to the promoter sequence. After binding of these transcriptional factors, then RNA polymerase enzyme, which is responsible for the transcription, will bind to the promoter sequence and thus initiating the transcription process. Okay, and a gene can have more than one promoter sequence. That means any gene may contain more than one promoter sequence. Okay, it is based on the gene. And the enhancer, this enhancer increases transcription by binding an activator protein. That means by binding of an activator protein to the enhancer, what will happen? There will be increase in the transcription process. This is the major purpose of the enhancer. And coming to silencer, this whenever a repressor protein, whenever a repressor protein come and binds to silencer, then this transcription process will be stopped. And how it will work? By binding of this repressor proteins to the silencer, this DNA or the fragment of DNA will not be available to the RNA polymerase enzyme, which will transcribe this DNA into mRNA. Okay, what will happen? Bind of repressor protein and make the DNA less available to RNA polymerase, and also contain untranslated regions at both ends, which contain a ribosome binding site. That means this DNA fragment will also contain untranslated regions. Okay, these will contain untranslated regions at the both ends. Okay, which contain a ribosome binding site and terminates and start and stop codons. That means these are responsible for the starting and stopping of the transcription, and for this process, untranslated regions which are start, stop codons, regulatory sequences are present at the both ends of this DNA fragment. And in addition, most eukaryotic open reading frames contain untranslated introns which are removed before the exons are translated. That means here every gene or DNA fragment contain both introns and exons. Introns are the untranslated or unnecessary fragments, whereas exons are the translated fragments. Okay, that means after transcription process, these introns should be removed from the DNA mRNA fragment so that translation will be carried uninterruptedly. Okay, so here in this eukaryotic open reading frames, it will also contain introns along with the exons. These introns are untranslated and these should be removed. So for the removal of these introns, the silencer will be used, as this repressor proteins will bind, and by that this particular introns will be removed. So this is the structure and nature of the gene. Okay, now let's see about DNA as genetic material. Okay, DNA as genetic material. In our syllabus, we just need to see the experimental proofs for this DNA as genetic material. Okay, we can see two important experimental proofs, and the first one is Griffith experiment. Okay, Griffith experiment. In the year 1928, British bacteriologist Frederick Griffith conducted a series of experiments using Streptococcus pneumoniae bacteria on mice. Okay, that means this British bacteriologist. Bacteriologist means is a scientist or a researcher who work on bacteria. Okay, and he is Frederick Griffith, and he conducted a series of experiments. That means this is not a single experiment, series of experiments on mice using the Streptococcus pneumonia bacteria. Okay, and he conducted this experiment in the year 1928. Actually, Griffith was not trying to prove DNA as genetic material by this Streptococcus pneumonia and mice, but actually he is developing a vaccine against pneumonia. Okay, that means by injecting the Streptococcus pneumonia bacteria to mice, he is conducting an experiment to develop vaccine against pneumonia. Okay, as pneumonia is caused by Streptococcus pneumoniae bacteria, by working on this bacteria and mice, he wanted to develop a vaccine for the pneumonia. But while working on this vaccine, he accidentally he proved DNA as genetic material. Okay, so now let's see how his experiment was carried. Okay, in this experiment, Griffith used two related strains of bacteria known as R and S. That means he have taken two different strains of Streptococcus pneumoniae. Okay, as we all know, every bacteria will contain different strains of those particular species. Okay, so here he have taken two strains, R strain and S strain. Simply you can remember, you can understand, R means rough. Remember, R means rough and S means smooth. Okay, that means rough Streptococcus pneumonia and smooth Streptococcus pneumonia strains were selected by Griffith for his experiment. Okay, of course he started this experiment for the development of a vaccine, but this is, by this experiment he proved DNA as the genetic material in organisms. Okay, so now let's see what is R strain and what is S strain. R strain, when grown in a petri dish, the R bacteria formed colonies or clumps of related bacteria that had well-defined edges and rough appearance. Okay, that means you have taken R strain Streptococcus pneumonia bacteria and he growed them artificially on petri dishes at in laboratory. Okay, that means he have given an artificial media. That means he have developed and growed that bacteria in artificial media in the laboratory. He prepared a artificial media and poured in the petri dishes, and he inoculated that petri dish with the this R strain bacteria, that is Streptococcus pneumonia, and after couple of days or couple of hours also we can observe this colony development. Okay, colonies will be formed, or clumps, small clumps may also observed on these petri dishes. And whenever these colonies are bacterial strain colonies were observed under microscope. They contain a well-defined edges and rough appearance on their surface. That means bacterial surface contains different edges and rough appearance. Okay, the R bacteria were non-virulent meaning that they did not cause sickness when injected into a mouse. Of course, it is mice, not mouse. Okay, here R bacteria, that is rough surfaced bacteria, non-virulent. That means these are not poisonous. Virulence means it is virulence, which means poisonous. This is non-virulent, which means it is non-poisonous and it is non-infectious. When injected to a mice, when this R bacteria or R strain of Streptococcus pneumonia was injected to a mice, what happened? That mice doesn't show any infection symptoms or any symptoms for pneumonia. Okay, why? Because this R strain is a non-virulent strain, and due to the presence of this rough appearance and the rough strain, this is a non-virulent strain. And S strain, on the other hand, we have the S strain. He also taken this S strain, and S colonies formed are rounded and smooth, and the smooth appearance was due to polysaccharide or sugar based coat produced by bacteria. This coat protected the S bacteria from the mice immune system, making them virulent. And mice injected with live S strain bacteria developed pneumonia and died. Okay, what happened? On the other hand, he also growed, or he also developed S strain Streptococcus pneumonia bacteria in the petri dishes with artificial or artificial media in the laboratory. Okay, after the formation of the colonies, he also observed these colonies under microscope, and how they look, they are round and smooth in appearance. Okay, when observed under microscope, these S strain Streptococcus pneumonia bacteria are round in shape, and they have a smooth surface over their bacterial cell. And why the smooth appearance is present means this smooth appearance is due to the presence of a bacterial coat. Okay, bacterial coat with polysaccharides or sugar base. Okay, this bacteria contain a special coat with polysaccharide or sugar components, and this particular coat is protecting that S strained Streptococcus pneumonia bacteria from immune system of the mice. Okay, this is a special coating for the S strain Streptococcus pneumonia bacteria from the immune system of the mice. Okay, and because of this became non-virulent strain, and it is capable of causing infection in that mice, and finally it developed pneumonia symptoms and it died ultimately. Okay, so these are the two stages of the experiment. Initially he conducted, and R strain bacteria doesn't cause any infection in the mice, and S strain bacteria caused infection and the mice was dead. Okay, so let's see this experiment in detail. Okay, and as part of his experiment, he conducted four series of experiments. Okay, here if you see the diagram, you can simply understand. First two stages are injecting smooth virulent bacteria to the mice, and due to its virulence it infected mice and it died. And the giving of this or injecting of this rough virulent strain to the mice, and as the strain is non-virulent, it doesn't show any infection or any virulence in that particular mice, and it is alive. And these are the first two steps. And the next step is, he have taken smooth heat killed bacteria. Here what he did, he have taken smooth strain Streptococcus pneumonia, and he have heat killed that particular microorganisms. That means he heated that bacteria, and by which that particular bacteria will be denatured. Its cell wall will be denatured, and due to the absence of the special coat, this virulence will be removed. Virulence nature of that particular strain will be removed, and even after injecting that smooth strain heat killed bacteria into that mice, it is alive. And in the last step, what he did is have taken a virulent cells and heat killed virulent cells. Okay, a virulent cell means which is a rough strain, and heat killed virulent strain means this bacteria which is used in the third series or third step. That means smooth strain and heat, which is a heat killed bacteria, have taken both in the combination and injected to the mice, even though mice was died. Why? Even though this heat killed bacteria doesn't contain coat, what will happen, this heat killed bacteria, even though it is died, what will happen, this virulent cell will provide the few components, and the coat will be provided from this heat killed bacteria. So finally a virulent strain will be formed, and it will cause infection in the mice, and mice will be dead ultimately. Okay, so let's see these four steps in detail now. When the smooth virulent S strain, which is encapsulated, is injected to mice, the mice is affected by the virulence of the S strain, and mice is dead. So this is the first step. What happened? Smooth virulent S strain, it is a encapsulated, that means it contains a special coat made up of polysaccharides, and this will give protection from the immune system of the mice. Okay, and because of that, what will happen, mice immune system is not capable of acting or to kill this an antigen, and what will happen, obviously this mice will be infected, and after a few days of the infection it will die. And in the next stage, the rough non-virulent R strain, which is non-capsulated, is injected to mice. Okay, which is a rough non-virulent R strain is injected, and the mice is not affected by the non-virulent R strain, and the mice is not affected by the R strain. Due to this, the mice is alive. Okay, that means as non-capsulated, this is non-capsulated, and mice immune system can effectively act on this R strain non-virulent bacteria, and it can kill that antigen and it will be protected from the infection and ultimately mice will be in alive condition. Okay, and the third step of the experiment, the smooth heat killed S strain is injected to mice. The mice is not killed by this heat killed S strain and the injected mice is not affected by this heat killed S strain, hence mice is in living condition. Okay, as even though smooth S strain is a virulent strain, here this smooth heat killed S strain is injected to mice. Mice is not killed by the heat kill. Why? Because it is not affected from this S strain, as S strain bacteria is heat killed. That means its a cell is damaged even though it's and even though its coat is its coat is present, but inside the coat bacteria is dead. So it cannot cause any infection and the mice is in live condition. And the fourth step, if we see the fourth step, the non-virulent R strain and heat killed S strain both were combined and this combination was injected to the mice. When the mice is affected by this non-virulent and virulent, mice is dead because of this strain. What happens? Bacterial cell will be provided from the R strain and capsule will be provided from the heat killed S strain. So again a virulent strain will be developed and this virulent strain will infect the mice and ultimately mice will be dead. Okay, so this is how we explain here DNA as genetic material. Okay, that means due to the presence of the due to presence of this genetic material only, here this experiment was successful. Okay, and the next one is Hershey and Chase experiment. So this is the next experiment which is done on bacteriophage. Okay, so let's see about this. Hershey and Chase studied bacteriophage or viruses that attack bacteria. Okay, bacteriophages, we all know bacteriophages are the viruses and these infect bacteria. These depend on bacteria for their survival. That's why we call them as bacteriophages. The phages, they used were simple particles composed of protein and DNA with the outer structures made of protein and inner core consisting of DNA. That means bacteriophages, these are simple structures and composed of proteins and genetic material DNA. And outer surface or outer structure is made up of protein and inner core will consist of the genetic material DNA. Here Hershey and Chase knew that the phage attached to the surface will attach to the surface of the host bacterial cell wall and injected some substances, either DNA or protein, into the host. That means they are not sure with the component that this particular bacteriophage is releasing into the bacterial cell for the infection. Okay, it might be DNA or it might be protein, but by the end of this experiment they confirmed that the genetic material DNA is being injected or DNA is being released into the bacterial cell for the infection. Okay, so prior to the experiment, what they know? They know that this bacteriophage can attach onto the surface of the host bacterial cell and will release some substance that might be DNA or protein into the bacterial host cell. This substance gave instructions that caused the host bacterium to start making lots and lots of phages in phages. In other words, it was the phage genetic material. That means after the release of this unknown substances into the bacterial host cell, what will happen? The particular substance is instructing, or it is due to that particular substance, bacteria will start developing number of phages in that particular bacterial cell. And finally, mainly it is developing bacteriophage genetic material in that particular bacterial host cell. Before the experiment, Hershey thought that the genetic material would prove to be protein. That means he thought protein as the genetic material. Okay, that means before any experiment, every scientist will have few assumptions. Okay, this is a assumption of Hershey. Okay, what he assumed? This genetic protein might be the genetic material is the assumption of Hershey. To establish whether the phage injected DNA or protein into host bacteria, Hershey and Chase prepared two different batches of phages. Okay, so as they are not they doesn't have any confirmation between DNA and the protein, they developed two batches of these phages. In each batch, the phage was produced in the presence of specific radioactive element, which was incorporated into the macromolecules DNA and protein that make up the phage. That means in both the batches, what they did, they simply labeled these phages with specific radioactive elements. Okay, and to the DNA and to the protein protein components, and due to presence of this radioactive elements, they can easily identify this component which is entering the bacterial cell. So that is the major idea of the experiment. So one sample was produced in the presence of S35 radioactive isotope of sulfur, and sulfur is found in many proteins and is absent from DNA. So only phage proteins were radioactive labeled by this sulfur. That means sulfur is a component which can be seen in proteins. And so what they did is they used this sulfur 35 radioisotope, and so as this is the component present in proteins, it will attach to the proteins and not to the DNA. Okay, and the other sample was produced in the presence of radioisotope P32, okay, phosphorus, as the genetic material contains phosphate groups. This P32 radioactive isotope is used to label genetic material, whereas protein components were labeled with this sulfur 32 radioisotope, okay, 35 radioisotope, and this DNA genetic material is labeled with P32 radioisotopes. Okay, okay, both protein components and DNA components, both are labeled with two different types of radioisotopes. Okay. And this phosphorus is found in the DNA, not in proteins. So only phase DNA was radioactively labeled by this treatment. As our DNA, the genetic material consists of this phosphorus backbone. So these radioisotope P32 will bound to the phosphate backbone. Okay. Each batch of phage was used to infect a different culture of bacteria. After infection had taken place, each culture was drilled in a blender, removing any remaining phage and phage parts from the outside of the bacterial cell. Finally, the cultures were centrifuged or spun at a high speed to separate the bacteria from phage debris. Okay. And the next step, what they did, each batch of phage was infected on this bacterial cultures. That means using these bacterial phages, which are labeled with different isotopes, that is S35 and P32, these two bacteriophages were infected to the bacterial cultures. Okay, after infection. And for some period of time, that bacterial culture will be grown, and after particular time, this culture will be separated, and this will be centrifuged to separate bacterial components and the phage components separately. Okay, and they might take this bacterial culture into the blender to remove the phage particles, or they can also use cultures in the centrifuge machines to separate this bacteria and phage debris. Okay. Centrifugation causes heavier material such as bacteria to move to the bottom of the centrifuge tube and form a lump called a pellet. Okay, we all know after centrifugation of any components, what we will get? A pellet and a supernatant. Here, bacterial cultures will be moved to the bottom of the centrifuge tube and form a pellet. That means we'll have this bacteriophage material in the supernatant. Okay, and the pellet will contain the bacterial components. Lighter material such as medium broth used to grow the cultures along with phage and phage parts remains new at the top of the tube and form a liquid layer called supernatant. That's what I explained before. That means supernatant will contain the phage parts and the phage material, and also the medium or the broth in which this particular bacteria is grown. Okay, if you see the diagram, you can get a better idea. First, DNA of bacteriophage is labeled with P32, and this is attached to the bacterial cell, and it will infect that bacterial cell, releasing the genetic material. Okay. And after centrifugation of this particular culture, what will happen? Bacterial components will form a pellet, and other bacteriophage materials and the broth material will form a supernatant. And P32, which is labeled to the viral bacteria, viral genetic material, that is DNA, this even genetic material of bacteria will also be taken over with this phage genetic material, and finally it will be brought to the bottom of the pellet, and we can found the radio labeled genetic material along with the bacterial genetic material at the pellet. And coming to the protein part, This sulfur 35 is labeled to the protein part. That is nothing but the outer protein capsid is labeled with S35, and this is infected to the bacterial cell. And finally, here what will happen? DNA will be released to the bacterial cell, and after centrifugation, there will be no presence of this radio labeled component in the bacterial pellet. Only the protein part will be consisting of this labeled S35 isotope. Okay. When Hershey and Chase measured radioactivity in the pellet and supernatant, from both of these experiments, they found that a large amount of P32 appeared in the pellet, whereas almost all of S35 appeared in supernatant. That means genetic material is which is labeled with P32 is brought to the bottom of the pellet, and S35 is present in the supernatant. Based on this and similar experiments, Hershey and Chase concluded that DNA and not the protein was injected into the host cell, and this made up the genetic material of the host. Okay. So, as after infection of this bacteriophage, what will it do? It will hijack that particular bacterial cell, and it will stop the bacterial cell metabolism, and it will instruct that particular bacterial cell to produce or develop bacteriophage components like genetic material. This genetic material will combine with the bacterial genetic material, and it will bacteriophage genetic material will be replicated with the help of bacterial genetic material. And also expression of this genetic bacteriophage genetic material will lead to the production of the protein components, that is protein capsid or the other necessary protein coat and protein protein based tail plate or tail pins, tail fibers. All these were produced by the expression of the bacteriophage genetic material, which is replicated with the help of bacterial genetic material. So this is how Hershey and Chase finally proved DNA is a genetic material which is meant for the infection of this any bacterial cell with bacteriophage genetic material. Okay, please keep the material with you while listening to the class, and if you have any doubts, please contact me. Thank you, students.